Our second speaker for this evening is Leimomi Kanagusuku. She's coming up right here. She was born and raised in Mai'ili. She attended Kamehameha Schools Kapalama and went on to continue her education at Stanford University in California and graduated with a BA in Human Biology, Health in Underserved Communities. So Human Biology, Health in Underserved Communities. Leimomi also graduated from the Imi Ho'ola Post-Baccalaureate Program at John A. Burns School of Medicine and is now a first-year medical student at JABSM. So we're happy to have her here, and she's still getting mic'd up, but this is Leimomi.
Aloha and good evening. I'm so good to see you all here tonight. I'm really nervous. My heart is pounding, but it's so good to see all your lovely faces. Can everyone hear me okay? Cameraman is good? Okay.
Oi.
All right. So like Christy said, I am a first-year medical student at the John A. Burns School of Medicine over in Kaka'ako, but it's under the UH Manoa system. I'm from Mai'ili. I was born and raised on Kaukama Road, which is on the other side, the ag land side. So I grew up on a chicken farm. We'll talk a little bit about that later. But I was humbly given this opportunity by one of my close mentors, Dr. Volich. She is a pediatrician over at the COMP, Wai'anae Coast Comprehensive Health Center. And then she's also a professor over at John A. Burns School of Medicine. She knew that I was from Wai'anae, and then she told me about this series. So she was like, oh, I think you should do it. And I said, what? I'm 24 years old. Like, what do I have to say? What do I have to share? And then she was like, no, there's a lot you can share. So I said, okay, maybe. I don't know if she's right still, but I'm gonna try my best. I talked it over with Christy, and she just told me to share my story, so that's pretty much what I'm gonna do with you this evening. I'm gonna share my story, but I didn't wanna call my presentation my journey, so I decided to pick Olalo Noeo. And this one is one of my favorites. It's Lawe I Ka Ma, alea a ku ono ono. So that means acquire a skill and make it deep. And to a lot of us, that may seem like, oh yeah, that makes sense, right? Like, oh, you're just supposed to do something and like do it to the best of your ability. But I think it means so much more than that. And I'm gonna try and relate that to my story with you this evening, okay? So let's go ahead. All right, so one of the first things that I should share with you is I should start from the beginning. So this is my house over on Kaukama Road. Like I said, I grew up on a chicken farm. I lived with my mom, my grandma, my sister, and my two uncles. My grandma was the one who mainly raised me while mom was going to work. So I spent a lot of the time in the yard. So it wasn't as much gardening and as much, you know, food stuff as they do at Ma'o Farms, but we had like, this is an avocado tree, we had mango, you know, ulu tree, typical kind of stuff that we always grow in our yard. And then I would just dig weeds, or I would try to dig weeds. You know, like grandma used to be like, oh, this is a weed. I'm like, grandma, that just looks like grass to me. It's green. So it took me a really long time to be able to figure out what a weed was. And so I just made like mud cakes or something, you know. She's like, well, just go water the plants then, you know, go do something. So that's what I ended up doing, and that's how I grew up. But I loved it, and that's where I spent my childhood up until I was 18 and graduated from high school. People are always really surprised that I'm from Wai'anae, right? Because I look like this. So they're like, what? I thought you're from Mililani. I was like, no, I'm not. But I, you know, being raised on that kind of, you know, this kind of place was just, it humbled me. It was a really simple lifestyle. I was disciplined just like any other child. So I really appreciated those types of things, and it kept me rooted in the important things in life. So this is just another picture of our yard. You can see all like the little chicken coops, a lot of the trees that we had. And then this is our ulu tree that we have in the front yard. So that brings me to my first point to relate to the Olalo Noeo, And it's remember your roots. Much like a tree grows, it has to have, a big tree like this needs to have expansive roots, right? It cannot just be like this big thing on top and little skinny roots on the bottom, because otherwise it's not gonna stand. It's not gonna withhold all the wind and the rain and all the elements, right? So it's, that is the part, integral part of fostering any skill. It's the family that you need to remember. It's your culture. I'm Hawaiian, so Hawaiian culture was a big thing for me. It's where you grew up, it's your morals, it's everything that you base your whole life upon. And I think that is a big part of what skill you pick to decide to really invest yourself in. And that's really what's gonna get you through the hard times, even when you wanna give up. So I think my number one rule is to always remember your roots. Oh, that's my mom and my grandma. They're like the two most important people. My sister's in the front. She knows she's important. I just didn't have a picture of her. So the next one is foundation is key. So I went to Kamehameha preschool, and then I was blessed enough to get into Kapalama when I was in kindergarten. Again, this is another thing people say, oh, you went to Kamehameha? You're Hawaiian? No, yeah, I am. I promise. My great grandma was full Hawaiian. I know I don't look it, but my name is Leimomi. I was named after my grandma, Virginia Leimomi Perkins. And yeah, so my last name is Kanagusuku, so that is what I look like, a Kanagusuku. But education was a really big thing for my family. My family was born and raised in Kalihi, Alava Heights area, so all of them went to Farrington, go Govs. But I have to represent the Warriors, go Imua Warriors. And they, you know, they didn't go to college, so I was a first generation college student, that's what they term it now, if you're the first one to go. So, you know, my grandma, since I spent a lot of time in my childhood with my grandma, I did a lot of hooked on phonics. I don't know if they still do that anymore, but they're like A, A, apple, B, B, ball, right? Like, you just keep saying that over and over again. I was like, Grandma, I'm so tired. She's like, do it again. So I was like, okay. So, I mean, like, education was a really big thing for my family. And, you know, like Sheree said, it was, you know, typical Hawaiian family, like, you want your kids to do better than you. So that's really what my grandma and my mom, them fostered. So it was really nice. You know, my grandma would like stay home, help me color. You know, she's like, you're coloring outside the lines. But I'm like, I'm trying my best, grandma. I'm only 5 years old. So it's weird because I liked school. Like, you know, I was just one of those weird kids that like really liked school. I don't know why. It just was fun to me. And I still really, really enjoy it. And I better because I have a lot more of it. So Kamehameha Schools was, it was amazing. It was an amazing experience. I did so many things with that school. Like, oh, I cannot even count how many blessings I've had from them. I learned to swim. I got to go to lots of the different islands with choir. I was in the Kamehameha Schools Children's Chorus. I got to sing with Lilo and Stitch when we were like in sixth grade, so that was really fun. They flew us up to Los Angeles for the premiere. That was my one of my favorite memories. We learned about our Hawaiian culture. Probably one of the biggest things I regret is not staying in Hawaiian language. I think we're required to do it from like kindergarten through sixth grade, but that's just like the really simple stuff, like how to count and your numbers and your colors, and that's about it. But I think they're trying to promote it a lot more, and I wish that I was part of that initiative. I took Japanese, and I don't know any of it anymore. So my sister actually took Hawaiian, which I'm super jealous. I tried to take Hawaiian in Stanford. So yeah, they offer Hawaiian at Stanford, and I thought that was amazing, but I only took it for like one quarter because then I had to graduate. But yeah, so besides other things that I did at Kamehameha, you know, we got to do PE. Like, everyone's like, oh my gosh, do you know what I had to do for PE today? I had to run 5 miles. Yeah, seriously, we run like that much. They make you do a biathlon, and everyone like from Punahou and Yolani and like everywhere else, they're like, what do you do for PE? And we're like, we did a biathlon, guys. So, I mean, it's the little things that I think that they incorporate into their curriculum that really make a big difference. As far as wanting to become a doctor, I think that I don't really know where I got that idea. My grandma was just like, oh, you know, you can be anything you want to be. You know, a doctor sounds good, or a lawyer sounds good. You know, like you imagine your child, you know, going into like these really, you know, high achieving type of things. And I was like, oh, okay, I don't really know what a doctor does or a lawyer does really, but maybe. So I know that they just wanted the best for me. And it didn't really click until my grandma had a heart attack when I was in sixth grade. So then we spent a lot of time in the hospital. We basically lived there for a really long time. She had to go to rehab too because she had a stroke. So, you know, always being surrounded by these medical people, like you, there's nurses, physical therapists, doctors, all these kinds of people, cardiologists. And I was like, wow, like this seems super, kind of exciting, you know? So that got me thinking to maybe I can be a doctor. But I didn't really give it much thought. I was like, okay, well, I just want to do well. I just want to pass my classes, that's all. So I knew I liked science. And then I figured, okay, that'll keep me on the track to being a doctor. I think they do science, something like that. That brings me to my second point, which is foundation is key. You know, your ABCs, 1, 2, 3s, the things you learn early on, I think that's really important for acquiring a skill and, you know, really, really investing in it and getting to know that skill on a deeper level. It provides the essentials, and those are the things we learn both in and out of the classroom. You know, so it's not everything is ABC, 1, 2, 3. Not all knowledge can be learned in a classroom. So these are things just like my mom and grandma taught me, things, you know, you learn on the playground, just how to be nice, how to treat other people kindly. So just things like that. So before I decided to do my career, I had to figure out, where am I going to go to college? So I don't know. I mean, I see a few people who are like in high school age maybe, or, you know, they're kind of younger, but college applications are terrible. Like, this is how it makes me feel when I look at them. This is my dog. We had, her name is Blue, and we got her maybe about 3 years ago. She was still puppy then. But it's so draining. Like, you look at it, and you gotta do an application, which is like a bajillion pages long. Then you have to like do extracurricular activities, and you're supposed to know that you're supposed to do the extracurricular activities beforehand. You're supposed to know that you're supposed to volunteer. Then you gotta get 2 teachers or like 4 teachers to write nice things about you, which, I don't know, that might may or may not have been the case. And then you gotta take a test, which is long, it's like 4 hours. And then on top of that, after, if you're not like Paul thinking about it by then you gotta think, oh my God, now I gotta pay for it. So you gotta write all your essays, and it really does take a lot of time. I was fortunate enough, like, I did do dance throughout my career in school. I did some volunteering opportunities, like feeding the homeless and, you know, just doing things like that. I think my teachers liked me. You don't even get to see what they write in the letters of recommendation, so you hope that they write something good. You just pray, like, oh, please write something nice, or just don't write something bad, at least. So it's really tiring. I remember sitting at my computer on New Year's Eve, like trying to turn everything in before the deadline. I'm like, okay, I know we all procrastinate, but that was not a good situation. We should not procrastinate. but it was really stressful. And I guess it was a little bit harder because my parents had not gone to college, so they didn't really know how to fill out these applications, right? So I think my parents just expected me to just fill it out. They're like, oh, don't you have to do your stuff? And I'm like, yeah, I guess I gotta fill out everything. And then when it came time to do FAFSA, which is another nightmare because, you know, that's like a whole nother application with everyone's money stuff. And I'm like, Mom, did you guys do your taxes? She's like, no. And I'm like, but I need to do it for financial aid. So, I mean, that kind of just went out the window. And it just takes a long time to look for scholarships and look for where you want to go. And I honestly didn't really research where I wanted to go to college. I just thought, oh, Stanford, that sounds good. So I applied to like USC. I applied to a lot of West Coast places, Oregon, Washington. I tried applying to Harvard. They rejected me real fast. But it's okay. I mean, I got some rejection letters and then I got some acceptance letters. So when I got the email from Stanford, I was like, yes, yes. But then I was like, oh my gosh, I don't even know where Stanford is. Okay, right? So I mean, that's my next point, my third point. Do your research. Like it takes a lot of time and it's a lot of investing, but you need to do your research. And I mean, this isn't even just for college stuff. You know, it's just about anything that you want to do, whether it's like buying a house, buying a car, buying a new refrigerator, whatever. Whatever you need to do, do your research. Make sure you know what you're getting yourself into, because then you can really invest your own self into it and make the best decisions that you can. Okay. So my next point is to be flexible. So right after I graduated high school, I worked at Macy's. I was in the This Is It section. That was a cool section with all the hip clothes. That was really fun. I didn't really work at a cash register before. Well, that was my first job, so anything was cool. I don't like shopping, so I was just folding clothes all day and like trying to check people out, but it was fun. And then I went up to Stanford and I found out it's in Northern California. So just make sure you know where you're applying to if you're applying to college. When I got to Stanford, I was actually super overwhelmed. I thought, I mean, Kamehameha did a really good job at preparing us for college, I think, as far as academics. But, you know, when you get to some place and then you're like, oh, you know, Kamehameha is like very, very ordered. Everything, you have all your periods, you have everything set for you. Everything is pretty much made up. But then you go to college and then it's like, oh, I can do anything. I can just do whatever I want to do. I can be whatever I want to be. I can take whatever classes I want to take. And I can join whatever clubs I want to join. So to me, it was a little bit overwhelming because I had lived kind of in a bubble, kind of per se. But it was really good. I had a chance to work with other natives, so Native Alaskans and Native American kids. We took a trip up there before school started, and then that helped us get a little bit acclimated. But everyone is like so smart, and everyone has this thing that they're really good at. And then here I was. They call it like duck syndrome, where, you know, the duck is just like floating on the water, but underneath it's like really paddling really hard. It's like, oh my gosh, I really gotta keep up with everybody else. And they think everyone has duck syndrome up there because, you know, you see all these people like doing really great things. Like I knew this one girl, she had already started her own business and she was like, you know, like an entrepreneur and stuff. And I know people who like knew how to make programs and apps and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And I was like, whoa, I don't even know what I want to do, you know? So you're put in that kind of environment and, you know, it's kind of stressful. So, and I definitely miss my family. They were all the way here in Hawaii and I was in California. So that was another thing I really needed to get used to. I was also shy and like, I didn't realize how much people talked in like the mainland. Like, I don't know, I just didn't really talk when I was a kid. And then in classes, you're always taught to like just listen and not really say anything. So, you know, when they like call, they're like looking at you and they're like, you need to say something. And I'm like, okay. So that took some getting used to too. But I mean, overall, it helped me come out of my shell and I met some really good people. And that was my, you know, my freshman first quarter, and it came time to pick a major. I was like, oh, so I had this grand plan. I was like, in high school, I was like, okay, I'm gonna become a biomechanical engineer, then I'm gonna graduate, and then I'm gonna apply to med school. And if I don't get into med school, then I'm going to just be a biomechanical engineer. Like, I mean, what is a biomechanical engineer though? I didn't even know. It just sounded really cool. So like, this is all things that you hear. And it just sounds really, really exciting. But I knew I liked physics and I knew I liked math. So that's why I thought engineer, and I thought, okay, it's related to medicine, I can like straddle it and that can be my backup plan. But then they had like this open house for all these different types of majors, and it was sociology, psychology, computer science. I was like, oh, I can be one of those computer people, like that sounds cool too. So everything sounded really, really good. And I was like, oh, what if medicine isn't for me? What if I'm like just setting myself up just for something that, what if I don't really like it? So I took some engineering classes, and then I took some graduation requirements, you know, just like the writing ones. And then I got a call freshman year Thanksgiving break from my mom, and she's like, Momi, grandma is sick. And I said, oh, what, I mean, like, what do you mean sick? And then it was just something that I've always dreaded, because I knew that, or I was just afraid that something would happen while I was away at college. And it just so happened, it happened while I was in my freshman year. So my grandma smoked for a really long time. So she was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. And I was already scheduled to come home for Thanksgiving break. So it worked out perfectly. I spent Thanksgiving that year in the hospital. The food was surprisingly okay. Hospital food isn't too bad, and on Thanksgiving at least. And I remember trying to finish my paper on my phone. Like, I didn't have internet service in the hospital, so I was like just desperately trying to finish stuff up. But that was kind of one of the biggest life-changing moments for me, since my grandma was somebody who's so close to me. And to see somebody so sick, who used to be this really vibrant person, it's really difficult. So I talked it over with my mom, and she was like, oh, I think you should come home. And I mean, to be honest, yeah, I think I was being a little bit selfish. I was like, oh yeah, I found this newfound freedom. I was independent. I was happy. I was happy at Stanford. And my mom wanted me to come home, and I was like, oh, I don't know if I want to. But I mean, deep down in my now, I was like, oh, you know what? That's the right thing to do. That's something my grandma would do for me. So that's what I did. I came home. I kind of just took a leave of absence from Stanford. So that was nice. I mean, they were really helpful. They were really accommodating about it. And then I enrolled at UH, which was a little bit more difficult to kind of enroll, I guess, once they already started enrollment. But it worked out. And I feel like it happens to kind of a lot of Hawaii kids who go away for college. I mean, not this particular case, but a lot of times they have to come home for whatever reason. A lot of times it's family. Because, you know, as a culture in Hawaii, we value family, we really do. And I just want people to know that it's okay, you know, whether it's your kids, your mo'opuna, your whatever, your niece, nephews. Like, not everyone's path is very straight, it's not always direct, and a lot of times we just need to be flexible, and that's my fourth point. Not everything is going to work out the exact way that we plan. Like, I thought, you know, I had my plan. I was like, da, 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 da. This is what I'm going to do, and that's just how I'm going to do it. But sometimes things just happen, and well, all the time things just happen, and they never really go as planned. And in order to acquire a skill and really, really, you know, be with it, I feel that you need to be flexible. In Kamehameha, we had teams that were named after trees, so we were on the ohe team, and they're like, guys, just be flexible, like the ohe. And I was like, okay, I don't know what that means. But now I understand what it means. You know, things are gonna come at you like no other. Sometimes things just happen one after the other, and it seems like, oh, I'm not gonna get through this. I don't know what I'm gonna do. But I think the main thing to remember is that you just have to stick with it, and that's really how you make a skill what it is. Okay. Oh, so I forgot. This is my college dorm. It's just like the typical college dorm. You shove everything in there. You buy all your snacks. And this was the campus that I really got to experience. So, I mean, it's acres and acres. It's like you bike everywhere because it's that expansive. So that brings me to what happened when I came home. So it was Christmas break. And this is my grandma and my cousins and my sister and me. She was going in and out of the hospital and then for her chemo and radiation. And then some things just got really bad right after New Year's. So she checked into the hospital, and she basically stayed there for a whole month. And I mean, I was enrolled at UH, but I wanted to stay with my grams to be able to watch her. You know, sometimes, you know, you just need help every once in a while. So you need somebody to talk to too. So yeah, I just stayed in the hospital and then went to class, and then I would come back, and me and my mom and my auntie would just do shifts. We would rotate. But yeah, it was probably the hardest time in my life. She passed away a few weeks later, and a lot of the things that I do now are for her. Sorry, I don't mean to cry, it's just emotional. Yeah, everything I do with my grandma in mind. And of all the things my grandma taught me, I think the thing that stuck with me the most was that you always do things out of love. And I think one of the things that we need to do is, or always keep in mind, are the things that matter. Like, no matter what, we have this plan, and we always want to do the things that we want to do. But sometimes the skill that we acquire, or that we're set out to do, like mine was medicine, sometimes things take us away from that, and that's okay, because those are the things that really matter in life. Like, to me, it was family. Family is the most important thing. So that is, you cannot replace the most invaluable things in your life. So sometimes you just need to take yourself out of whatever you're doing, and then just recognize what matters, really. Okay, and so after much thought, I decided to finish back up at Stanford. I worked at First Hawaiian Bank that summer. I wasn't a teller, I worked in the trust division, so that was interesting. I realized it wasn't for me. I don't enjoy sitting down all day and like looking at the computer. A lot of times I was just like reading. I was like, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. But it was good. You got to meet a lot of people, and you know, I think the number one thing is exposure. So it took some paperwork and stuff for me to get back to Stanford, but I eventually did go back for my sophomore year. And I took the maximum number of credits each year. And I was just like, okay, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna graduate. I'm gonna graduate for grandma. And there wasn't really much room to do anything else. I kind of had to just, you know, buckle down, and I wanted to complete my stuff early so I could come back home. And I joined a dance group called Chocolate Heads, which is like a cornucopia of just people who don't, not all of us had dance backgrounds, but it's just people who really love to dance. So that was really fun. I was really passionate about that. And I realized I don't want to be an engineer for the rest of my life. That is not what I want to do. I want to be able to talk to people and smile and, like, you know, be happy. Not that engineers aren't happy, but I think that medicine was something else for me. And I know a lot of people say, like, oh, I realized this, or I figured out that. And like, a lot of times some people don't get that because maybe they didn't have that aha moment, but for me that was my aha moment. And you realize what you do want in life and then what you don't want in life. So that was mine. I wanted medicine to be my life. I figured out I like social science stuff, so that was like psychology, sociology kind of things. And then I was deciding between a BS and a BA in human biology, or just biology. So I created my own major, which was great. That was one of the best things I could do at Stanford with the human biology course. So I did human biology with a concentration in health in underserved communities, because I was thinking, oh, Native Hawaiians, okay, what can I do with that? Because they're not gonna let me call it Native Hawaiian health. So I was just like, oh, health in underserved communities. And then we discussed like a lot of disparities that we saw among like indigenous populations as well as just minorities. I took a majority of my pre-med classes, but then I didn't take all of them. So what I tell a lot of people is like, you don't have to do everything in one place. And I, you know, college is expensive, and then things were a lot less expensive back home here. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna just graduate at Stanford, and then I'll come back home, LCC, UH, I'll just take the rest of my pre-med classes. So that's what I did. I interned at the Department of Native Hawaiian Health, which was amazing. We got to go to Kalaupapa on Molokai, the old Hansen's disease site. And the other fun job that I did, oh, this is me graduating from Stanford. This is what I did for a really long time. I worked at Roy's. I started from the bottom. I was a hostess. And I eventually like bussed, or you know, I was the person who like wiped the dishes and like set the tables, and then I eventually became a server. So that was really, really fun. I think of all the jobs that I've ever had, it was Roy's that really, really, really made me a happy person. And you know, you get to talk to all different kinds of people. And you know, like I said, I was shy, and California helped me come out of my shell. Roy's definitely made me come out of my shell, because you have to talk to all these people, and then a lot of them are not happy people, you know, like at the hostess stand, they're like, where's my seat? And I'm like, you know, and then you have to like come up with something. So I was like, oh, it's almost ready, and you have to do it with a smile, yeah? Aloha service, right? So I mean, I think that really, really helped me to understand what it means to serve people. And I think a lot of people in the health industry should do something like Roy's, or they should be a server, because you know, you have to really cater to people. You have to want to help them. You have to, you know, love to help them. You want to make them happy. You want to make them well. I wrote about working at Roy's for my medical school essay. And then I also graduated early in my junior year from Stanford. So like I said, and then my college career was over. Like poof, done. And I think because I was like so focused on just getting something done, and you know, I didn't want to be distracted by anything, it kind of just went over my head. And so I think that's one of the things that you know, you need to remind yourself too, is to enjoy what you love. You want to acquire skill, but you want to enjoy that skill. You want to be able to relish in it and be like, oh, I have all these memories from it, you know? I do have memories from college. I have beautiful memories, but I feel like I definitely could have enjoyed my time a lot more. And ever since my grandma passed away, I definitely have taken that into account and tried to live my life like that. So I went back to Roy's, and I was hostessing and doing everything. That has nothing, this like, none of these jobs, right? The internship, the internship kind of has to do with medicine, but First Hawaiian Bank and Roy's and Macy's and all these places, like what does that have to do with medicine? Like nothing, right? But like I said, I feel like it has a lot to do with it. So, because it helped me develop my personal skills. So that's what I mean by breadth versus depth. Like the Olalon says, you want to acquire a skill and make it deep. But I feel like making it deep also means having the breadth of knowledge. You cannot only just, you know, medicine, or like, you know, anything. You cannot just only focus on that. It has to be other things that you need to take into account, because otherwise, how are you going to relate it to other people? You know, it needs to be relatable. And then that's why I said, you know, find what you're good at, find what you love, work hard at it, and then try not to get distracted. But, you know, you want to enjoy it. You want to enjoy what you're doing. So other places that I worked were, so after I was Pauwels School, I emailed the director of public health at UH. And they're like, oh, we have something open at Department of Health, Hawaii State Department of Health. And it was the Rethink Your Drink thing. I don't know if you guys saw any sort of commercial for it or poster, but it's like this boy or this girl drinking lots of fat. So we're like trying to get lots of people to stop drinking soda or Gatorade or like things with sugary sweetened beverages. So that was actually really fun. Like that also, I mean, it kind of has to do with medicine, but it was just more communication skills that I had to do. I worked with the Wai'anae High School program, and then we did the Youth Health Corps. So that was exposing high school kids to medicine, which I thought was really great, because I wish I had that. I mean, we did have some speakers at Kamehameha come in and tell us about, you know, why we should do medicine, why it's cool. But these people actually like got to suture stuff. Like we bought these pig's feet and then we, you know, practice suturing. You know, you do CPR, you go and see the La'au Lapa'au people. You know, so it's not only Western medicine, and it's not only like being a doctor, you know, everyone can go into like nursing, a whole bunch of different things. So I thought that was another really, really good program. But then it came time for me to finally like buckle down and apply to medical school. Oh, this is what we did with youth health corps. So these are like parts of the cadavers and stuff. So it came time to apply to med school, and med school applications, guess what? They're the exact same as like regular applications. So I was tired again. I was like, oh, application, extracurriculars, volunteering letters, hoping that, you know, some of my Stanford teachers would like even remember me. I was like, oh my gosh, I don't even know if they're gonna remember who I am. I hope so. I tried studying for the MCAT, so that's the, oh yeah, so SAT or ACT is supposed to be MCAT. It's different when you go into medical school. But yeah, it's so hard to study while you're going to school, and I really, really applaud the people who do that. I was working every single day at Roy's, well, I worked at Monkey Pod too, so right next to each other, but yeah, I didn't have a day off. I maybe had like 5 days off out of the year, and I don't think, maybe like one of them was a holiday, you know, because Roy's is 24/7, 365. And I was like, okay, I was so burnt out. I was like, I don't even want to study for this. I just hope I can pass it. I didn't do that well. You people should study, okay? I thought, oh, maybe I should take a course, but no, those courses are like $500. I don't have time for that. I just went to a bookstore and I bought a review book, and it kind of worked. I didn't do that bad, but I didn't do that great. So I turned in all my applications, and I just waited. Again, I procrastinated, so I don't know why I didn't learn. I think, I don't know why I should have, but it was the whole thing all over again, and then I just had to wait. So, you know, about November came around, December came around, and I got rejection letter after rejection letter. I applied to maybe about 10 schools, and I really wanted to go to JABSM down here. And I got a rejection letter from every single one. None of them wanted me, and even the place that I really wanted to go. So I opened the letter, and my mom was sleeping on the couch, and I remember going up to my room and like opening it up, and I cried. I cried so hard. I was like, everything that I have worked for up until this time is pow. Like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. Like, what, I'm just gonna work at Roy's now, maybe? And then try again, or I don't know, like everything I'd worked for since like seventh grade. So imagine seventh grade through high school, through college, and then a couple years after that, I was like, okay, I feel a little bit defeated. And then January came around, I was like trying to study for more MCAT stuff. But you know, my spirit wasn't really with it. My heart was kind of broken. But then I got this email one day that kind of changed my life. It was in about April or May of 2013. And I had applied to this thing called the Imi Ho'ola Post-Baccalaureate Program. So they had accepted me, and I was like, yes, thank goodness. You know, it was the most relieving thing in the whole world for me. I was like, okay, now I have my second chance. Yeah, so now I have my second chance. And the Imi Ho'ola Post-Baccalaureate Program is, it's not for just Native Hawaiians, it's for people from all kinds of socially, economically disadvantaged status. So they try to address the need for primary care. So I know it was in the newspaper recently. I don't read the newspaper because I don't, I just cannot, I don't have time. But I heard it was on the front page, how we have a primary care shortage. And you know, we're trying to, a lot of the doctors that even are trained here go away. You know, they go to the mainland and we lose a lot of them. And these are the smart ones. These are the ones that really care about Hawaii and the people in it. And that's, you know, kind of sad that everyone goes there because either of pay, either their family is over there, or they go to school way over there, and we just lose them. So the Imi Ho'ola program actually does a really good job at keeping the people here. It's basically a year-long intensive program. They stick all the sciences that you learn in 4 years into 1 year. And it was the hardest thing I've ever done academically, probably in my entire life. So not only was I introduced to like medicine kinds of things academically, but you know, they introduced psychosocial. So they introduced like, why do Native Hawaiians get higher causes of health disease, or you know, how should you treat a patient who you know, has a social stigma, or things like that. And they introduce you to things. And if you graduate Imi Ho'ola, then you're guaranteed a spot. You have 12 spots in Imi Ho'ola, and you're guaranteed If you pass, into med school. You're guaranteed a spot into med school. So that's the another beauty of it. The thing is, it's a really rigorous course, so not everyone passes. They have maybe about a 75 passing rate. But I mean, I gained the foundation that I need to catch up on the science background, since I didn't really have that science background. And I was one of the blessed 8 who did pass. So this is a picture of us when we went to Kalaupapa. I got to go to Kalaupapa twice, so that's more than people can say in a lifetime. But yeah, it was one of the most amazing experiences, and all of these people are very, very dear to my heart. I mean, I think when you go through a trial or tribulation, such as school, that's very, I don't know, we all just like sat down and just were like, oh my gosh, how are we gonna pass this program? But I think when people have that type of experience, they tend to bond, and I mean, these people are basically my family. I love them to death. So we came out stronger than ever, and we have the support. The Imiho'ola faculty and staff are extremely supportive. They track us throughout our entire medical career, and that's, you know, it eventually worked out. This is us at our graduation. We're all so happy. We're like, oh my gosh, we passed, guys. We have a month of break, and then we got to start med school, so great. But it was good. I really appreciate this this opportunity. And the thing that I want to put in here is persevere, question, and work hard. So, I mean, during that time, I questioned, you know, was medicine right for me? I got rejected from all of these schools. Is this what I'm supposed to do? Is God telling me something? Like, maybe I shouldn't be doing this. But then I got offered this opportunity of a lifetime, and I made some really good friends, and I learned a lot. I learned a lot. And, you know, acquiring a skill and making a deep doesn't go without persevering, and it doesn't go without working hard. So, you know, a lot of times people think that some things just come easy, and I feel like if it comes easy, then, I don't know, sometimes it's just not worth it. You know, you want to work hard. Like, that's the whole point of life sometimes. You've got to work at it. Sometimes people just have talents, and that's good too. But I feel like working hard is still a major, major role in it. And then this is us. You know, we finally got into med school. There's this thing called a white coat ceremony. We're all being silly. But this was the highlight of our year, I think, because we had worked so hard in Imiho'ola, and we were finally in med school. We got to wear that nice white coat. This is the short white coat, so it's not the long one. But yeah, it just is a representation of how hard we worked. So I guess just to update you on what I'm doing right now, so I'm a first year medical student. I'm actually the class president. I do some research with Dr. Koholokula, who works with a lot of Native Hawaiian communities. Right now we're trying to write a research paper on how to do lifestyle interventions and then spreading it throughout communities so all of Hawaii can have it, and you know, even other places beyond Hawaii. My life goal right now, or where I see myself in 10 years, is just, I think I want to go into family medicine. Right now, a lot of people say that you change your mind, but I really love family medicine. It's primary care, it's something that I want to do, and I really want to come back to this community. Like I said, Dr. Volich is working at Wai'anae Coast Comprehensive, and she's a pediatrician there, and I got to shadow her, and she's amazing. So that's another thing about medicine. You get to see some really amazing people who inspire you, and she's one of them among many, many others. I don't know if I want to work at the comprehensive, but that would be great because I know that they're remodeling everything. But I for sure want to work here in Wai'anae. This summer I'm probably going to have the opportunity to work with Dr. Volich, and then hopefully shadow some other doctors. I don't know too much about La'au Lapa'au, but I'm hopefully gonna go ahead and shadow somebody over there. She's trying to hook it up for me. But yeah, that's kind of like the track that I'm on right now, just to give you guys an update. I believe that we need more people in the Native Hawaiian community and in Wai'anae and just in general in Hawaii
To be able to Lawe I Ka Ma alea a ku ono ono, so acquire a skill and make it deep. It's the only way our people will prosper. And it's not, you know, it's not just in the context of medicine. I don't expect everyone to become doctors from here. But I, you know, we talk to a lot of the kids in Nānākuli and Wai'anae, and I see so much potential. Right now I'm in the Kua'ola program at our school, and you know, a lot of them are so bright and so beautiful and vibrant and young, and they have so much potential, and it's really, really refreshing to see. I know I gave this in the context of medicine, but the lessons I learned, I think can be applied everywhere. It starts from a young age, so our keiki, that's why I really love working with kids. And we have to instill them to follow their dreams and their passions. The sky is not the limit. That someone from the west side is something definitely to be reckoned with. You know, a lot of people kind of just pass this over like, oh, you're from Wai'anae, you know, like whatever. But it, you know, we have something to offer, and I think we need to let everyone else know that. We need to remind them not to forget where we come from, and to give back and always remember our roots, to cherish life. To me, acquiring a skill and making it deep is more than just our job. It's more than medicine for me. It's about being the best mom, being the best dad, sister, brother, whatever that we can be. Because the skill of being a caring and loving and just good person inside, I think that's probably the best skill that we could possibly ever have. So thank you.
I'm interested in that very year where you were rejected by 10 students, and then I got the next one. What did you do in between yourself?
So I guess when I got rejected maybe in December and then didn't find out till April, so there's like that 4 months of limbo, I guess you could call it. I kind of just drove myself to working every single day, and I was like, okay, I'm just gonna try work, make enough money so that maybe I could eventually go to med school. Like, med school was still on my mind. I was just a little bit defeated at that point. I thought, oh, maybe I should study a little bit more. When I was on my med school interviews, they asked me, oh, why didn't you just take a retake? I mean, you can just take the test over again. And I didn't really think about it. I think I was just too mentally scarred from the test. I didn't want to take it ever again. So I just tried to refocus myself, I guess, and spend a lot of time with my family. And work. That's all I did.